Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the second annual ECAC Hall of Fame Gala and Induction Ceremony. My name is John Rollins, and I'm the Associate Vice President for Finance and Administration here, and I am a proud member, former athlete at Fordham University. Before we begin our program this evening, I ask that we bow your heads for the invocation. We are thankful for this day that is given us. Lord, please bless this food, this evening's honorees, former student athletes, coaches, administrators, family, and friends. We are all thankful for the opportunities and challenges that intercollegiate athletics has afforded us. May we continue to appreciate and use each day that comes to us. We pray for strength and guidance to handle each day's duties and each day's problems. May we be challenged to continue to give our best always in everything we do. Amen. Thank you. Please feel free to enjoy your salad and turn your attention to the video screens as we begin our evening. Thank you.
Don't forget the mimeograph machine in the bathtub of room 315 at the Roosevelt. This remark epitomizes the situation existing at the birth of this unique athletic conference, the largest and only multi-divisional organization in the United States. On January 2, 1938, what is now the ECAC started as the central office for the Eastern Collegiate Athletics, with its new executive director, Asa Bushnell, a secretary, a two-room suite at the Hotel Roosevelt, a $28,000 yearly budget, and the mimeograph machine in the bathtub. At the time, a number of Eastern Collegiate leagues and associations were going their own ways, duplicating efforts and spending unnecessary funds. The solution was reached when a dozen or so athletic administrators reached the conclusion that one central office would be a wise alternative. Bushnell headed the organization until 1970, introducing the practices of scheduling, recruiting officials, training them, and assigning. Initially, there were about 48 colleges. When World War II came along and college sports dwindled, Bushnell kept it alive and was ready for the great expansion in athletics. By 1952, the ECAC Holiday Basketball Festival was born. It became a tradition like no other in college sports. The Holiday Festival and other prestigious intercollegiate events such as the IC4A Track and Field Championships at Madison Square Garden, along with the National Invitation Tournament, which the ECAC coordinated from 1938 through 1980, were synonymous with the organization. In 1972, the ECAC staff was outgrowing its headquarters in New York City. Scotty Whitelaw had taken over as the ECAC commissioner, and a search committee with the help of the legendary Bill Flynn eventually selected what became the Bushnell Center in Centerville, Massachusetts as its new home. Another major milestone came in 1983 when, under the direction of Whitelaw, the ECAC became one of the first conferences in the nation to provide championships in women's athletics. That same year marked one of the most significant events in the history of the ECAC. Following the success of the championships, the EAIAW was consolidated into the ECAC, doubling the number of championships and greatly increasing its member base. The landscape of intercollegiate athletics was changed drastically over the years and is ever evolving, as is the ECAC. In the summer of 2014, the organization relocated its headquarters to a first-class facility with world-class amenities in the Matrix Corporate Center. The new location strategically positions the ECAC in the center of its membership. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the ECAC President and CEO, Kevin McGinnis.
CEO of the ECAC, Kevin McGinnis.
Thank you, Vinny. That was good. Thank you, Vinny. And thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Eastern College Athletic Conference, welcome again to the second annual ECAC Hall of Fame Gala and Induction Ceremony. We're here tonight to recognize a special group of individuals that have had an immeasurable impact on the world of college athletics, and specifically the ECAC. The 2016 class consists of 15 individuals and one team, which spans the entire history of the ECAC. It features former student athletes, coaches and administrators who have put forth outstanding achievements, service, and contributions to the ECAC-sponsored sports, programs, and events. This is an opportunity for these remarkable individuals to share their incredible achievements with family and friends and be forever recognized for their indelible mark that they have made on this organization. It's an evening of great pride and tradition. On behalf of the Matrix Corporate Center, the ECAC staff, our board of directors, and the entire ECAC membership, we extend our heartfelt congratulations to all of tonight's inductees, and thank you all for sharing in this very special evening. Before I introduce our Master of Ceremonies for this evening, I'd like to take this time to thank the ECAC Hall of Fame Selection Committee, who had the task of selecting this ECAC Hall of Fame Class of 2016. The Hall of Fame Selection Committee consisted of a member of our inaugural ECAC Hall of Fame class, Dr. Eve Atkinson, Tim Camp, another inaugural ECAC Hall of Famer, Don Cook, Kellyanne DeJulia Light, John Garner, Mark Griffin, Ferdina Ingold, Ed Krajewski, Dick Laskowski, Sean Morrison, Bill Sullivan, and Kate Whalen. Give them a round of applause for doing a wonderful job, please. I'd also like to recognize those present this evening from the ECAC Board of Directors. Our second Vice Chair and Director of Athletics from Rutgers Newark, Mr. Mark Griffin, Adelphi University Director of Athletics, Danny McCabe, Executive Director of the CUNY Conference, Zach Ifkovich, Director of Athletics at Hofstra University, Jeff Hathaway, Director of Athletics Emeritus from Penn State Altoona, Ferdina Ingold, and last but definitely not least is our ECAC Board of Directors past Chair, Fairfield University Director of Athletics, and one of tonight's honorees, Mr. Gene Doris. Thank you. The chair of our board of directors and director of athletics at Southern Connecticut, Jay Moran, was unable to join us. However, he wanted to send the following message. Honorees, ECAC friends, colleagues, and families, I'm sorry I couldn't be here tonight for this special occasion, the second annual ECAC Hall of Fame. Congratulations to all this evening's well-deserved inductees. A special congratulations from the SESU family to Coach A.B. Grossfeld, and congrats to my ECAC colleague and friend, Gene Doris. I'd also like to acknowledge and congratulate another friend who I miss dearly, Bob Hartwell. Bob was a mentor and an inspiration. And speaking of mentors, a big congratulations to Coach D. Rowe. There's no greater ambassador to the University of Connecticut and college athletics than Coach Rowe. Again, congratulations to all the ECAC Hall of Fame inductees. Also, I'd like to take a moment to remember all those friends and colleagues who have gone before us, in particular, ECAC Board of Directors member Keith Bullion from Salem International University, who passed away last month, members of last year's ECAC Hall of Fame class, or members of this year's ECAC Hall of Fame class, who we are honoring this evening posthumously, Ole Kolevelv, Bob Hartwell, and Jack Riley, and last year's inaugural ECAC Hall of Fame class members, Sue Peterson-Lubo from the United States Merchant Marine Academy, who passed away in October, and legendary ECAC Commissioner Scotty Whitelaw, who passed away week before last. Please give your attentions to the screen as we play a tribute to Scotty Whitelaw.
Scotty Whitelaw served as Commissioner of the Eastern College Athletic Conference from 1971 through 89. During Whitelaw's tenure, nearly 50 colleges and universities joined the ECAC, and when he retired, the conference sponsored over 90 men's and women's championships in 19 sports. Whitelaw helped to organize the National Ice Hockey Officials Organization in 1956 and was the architect of the annual ECAC Hockey Tournament, which began in 1962. Whitelaw was a tireless crusader for better rules, better officiating, better coaching, and better championships, all with an eye on providing the best possible experience for student athletes. In 1983, under Whitelaw, the ECAC became one of the first conferences in the nation to provide championships in women's athletics. That same year marked one of the most significant events in the history of the ECAC. Following the success of the championships, the EAIAW was consolidated into the ECAC, and it doubled its number of championships and greatly increased its member base. In addition to his dedication to the ECAC, he also served on the executive board of the National Football Foundation and Hall of Fame, and served as an advisor to the Metropolitan Intercollegiate Basketball Association, the sponsor of the National Invitation Tournament. He also served on numerous NCAA committees. The former ECAC commissioner was awarded the James Lina Distinguished Achievement Award in 1989, For former ECAC athletic administrators who have achieved outstanding success in their career and have made an unusual contribution in the interest of intercollegiate athletics, the NCAA, and the ECAC. In 1991, Whitelaw was honored with the ECAC Administrator of the Year Award in recognition of outstanding and meritorious service to the conference.
Just a quick story, as you all that knew Scotty, how wonderful a person he was. And from the day I got this job, and to the God's honest truth, he called me every month just to check in, just to see how I was doing. And he did that to so many of us here. And just a quick story, about a year and a half ago, I had the opportunity to play golf with Scotty on the Cape. God love him, he would get up, little waggle, hit it right down the middle in every single shot. And Ferdina Ingold was in the foursome. And Ferdina was driving the cart with Scotty. So we were playing one hole, and Ferdina drives up about 5 feet from the green. Well, the ranger came by. He started screaming, "What are you doing? What are you doing?" Ferdina looked right at the ranger. She said, "Hey, give him a break. He's 98 years old." But anyway, the ranger went and got the flag, and we were fine for the rest of the day. If we would, please, just a moment of silence to remember all of our ECAC friends and colleagues that have gone before us. Thank you. It's also my pleasure to publicly announce that upon the suggestion of Scotty's family, we have established the ECAC Scotty Whitelaw Memorial Fund to help sustain and perpetuate the mission of the ECAC. And we've already had some contributions to that. And again, that was Scotty's daughter, Kim Drake, who had that suggestion to certainly long live the legacy of Scotty Whitelaw. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce our Master of Ceremonies for this evening. He's a college basketball analyst on SNY, Fox Sports, ESPN, NBC Sports Radio, and Cox Hub. He's no stranger to the ECAC, covering the Big East, the Atlantic 10, and the MAC. He's an Iona College alum. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our Master of Ceremonies, Mr. Vin Parisi.
Thanks so much, Kevin. Thank you. It's always so much of an honor to come and MC this event every single year. I love it, and you know, the past few years, as Kevin has taken this organization to the next level, so much history, 78 years, and everyone that's honored tonight is such an ambassador through the ECAC and all the thousands and thousands of lives they have touched. Over 300 member schools, they oversee over 100 championships, and nearly 5,000 student athletes are served. And tonight is a huge reason why the ECAC has grown the last few years. So congratulations, give yourselves a round of applause for being a big part of that. That being said, as the MC, I am aware that my job is to shut up, keep it moving. The salads look fantastic, not too heavy on the dressing. I promise I will keep this cooking. Keep this moving and go along. So, without further ado, it is now time to recognize and get the 2016 Hall of Fame ceremony underway. Sorry, I lost my place here. I tried to get all organized and set up the papers for everybody, and then everybody comes up and has their own copies. So now we have more papers here than a presidential debate. I promise I will be with you shortly. Here we go. All right, ladies and gentlemen, our first inductee tonight, Ernie DiGregorio.
Homegrown in the shadow of Alumni Hall, North Providence, native Ernest A. DiGregorio Jr. not only defined the running friar tradition, but helped revolutionize college basketball's fast break offense. A wizard with the basketball, DiGregorio was a 1973 consensus All-American and led the Friars to their first Final Four appearance. Ernie D., as he's affectionately known, went on to win the Lapchick Award as the nation's outstanding senior. He was selected third overall in the 1973 NBA draft by the Buffalo Braves. He was named the league's Rookie of the Year and set a rookie record for most assists in a game with 25. DiGregorio was honored by the ECAC when they named him the Eastern Player of the Decade for the 1970s. In 1999, DiGregorio was elected to the National Italian American Sports Hall of Fame.
And it is with great pleasure and admiration that we welcome Ernie DiGregorio to the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Ernie cannot be with us tonight. Accepting the award on his behalf is Athletic Alumni Events Coordinator at Providence College, Harold Starks. Our next inductee is Mary Ann Hitchens.
Mary Ann Hitchens is a lifer at the University of Delaware. In 1963, she enrolled as a student, and until her retirement in 2006, she spent 37 years with the Blue Hens. Hitchens began her journey in 1969 as coach of the women's basketball team, field hockey, and swimming as the pilot programs for the women's athletic program at UD. She was designated the Senior Woman Administrator from 1977 until her retirement in 2006. Hitchens served on the ECAC Executive Council from 83 to 86 and received the ECAC Johnston's Distinguished Service Award in 1992 and the Catherine Lay Award in 2000. She was inducted into the State of Delaware Sports Museum Hall of Fame, the University of Delaware Athletics Hall of Fame, the UD Alumni Wall of Fame, and the National Field Hockey Coaches Association Hall of Fame. It is with great pleasure that we salute and welcome Mary Ann Hitchens to the ECAC Hall of Fame Class of 2016.
Congratulations, Mary Ann Hitchens. Let's hear it again, ladies and gentlemen. Congratulations to Mary Ann Hitchens. Our next inductee is Bob Hartwell.
Bob Hartwell spent 27 years at Adelphi University and turned the Division II school into a national powerhouse. Under his direction, the Panthers enjoyed tremendous success, garnering 10 NCAA championships, 10 NCAA regional championships, and over 100 NCAA appearances. Mr. Hartwell also played a vital role upgrading all athletic facilities on campus, creating the Panther Club and instituting the Cans for Cancer program. In 2008, he was the recipient of the NCAA Diversity Honor and twice received the NCAA Outstanding Contribution Award. In 2013, Hartwell was awarded the ECAC Commissioner's Award, which is presented for meritorious service to the ECAC or a member institution. Sadly, Mr. Hartwell passed away on April 11, 2014. And now it's time to take him to his rightful spot in the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Accepting the award on behalf of Bob is his daughter, Stephanie Hartwell. And his granddaughter. Let's hear it again, ladies and gentlemen. Congratulations to the Hartwell family. Our next inductee is Dee Rowe.
Dee Rowe has served the University of Connecticut as a coach, athletic administrator, and an ambassador for the past 47 years. He was named head coach of the Huskies in 1969. For 8 seasons, he directed the team to a pair of NIT berths and a trip to the NCAA Sweet 16 in 1976. He developed the University of Connecticut Development Fund in 1978, and for the next 13 years was a national advocate of UConn athletics. He was instrumental in building the Harry A. Gamble Pavilion and ushered the university into the Big East Conference in 1979. The following year, Rowe was set to be an assistant coach for his good friend Dave Gavitt, but the U.S. boycotted the 1980 Olympic Games in Moscow. The team did participate in the gold medal series, taking 5 of 6 games against an NBA All-Star team. In 2014, he was honored by the ECAC during the Madison Square Garden Holiday Festival with the ECAC Legends Award. It is with great honor that we welcome D. Rowe to the ECAC Hall of Fame, class of 2016.
Unfortunately, D and Ginny Rowe could not be with us tonight. Accepting on his behalf, please welcome Tim Tolokin. Congratulations to D. Rowe.
I just need to say a couple words. Those of you who know Coach Rowe, without saying he's the salt of the earth, and he was determined, correct Tim, he was determined to be here. Jeff saw him this morning. He's had a few health issues, and he's fought through them. He had an unfortunate last-minute surgery on Wednesday, or he would have been. He's with us with spirit, and he wanted to make sure that I got on the mic and I let everyone know how much he loves and cares about you and tonight's inductees, and it's a God's honest truth. He said that the other day, and I just would be remiss if I didn't say that, and I wanted to say that. And so let's cross your fingers and say a prayer for Coach Rowe. He's got 9 lives, right, Jeff? Right. He's going to have, we're hoping he's going to have about 99. So good luck, D.
D. Rowe, an ECAC legend for sure. Speaking of legends, our next inductee is Frank McLaughlin.
When you think of Fordham University athletics, one name comes to mind, Frank McLaughlin. A 1969 graduate and a standout basketball student athlete, McLaughlin went on to serve as an assistant coach at the College of the Holy Cross, and after a season, returned to Fordham under Digger Phelps. McLaughlin followed Phelps to Notre Dame, and then was named the head coach at Harvard, and he spent 8 seasons with the Crimson. In 1985, his alma mater came calling again. This time, it was to take over as the athletic director. In 1998, McLaughlin became the executive director of intercollegiate athletics and recreation. During his time, the Rams experienced success both on and off the playing fields. In 2012, McLaughlin was promoted to the position of Associate Vice President of Student Affairs for Athletic Alumni Relations and External Affairs, Athletic Director Emeritus. It is with great pleasure and admiration that we welcome Frank McLaughlin to the ECAC Hall of Fame, class of 2016.
Ladies and gentlemen, Frank McLaughlin.
Nice to see so many friends here. It's not easy getting up here from the Bronx. But when Kevin gave me a call, I was really thrilled. And then when I asked him who else was being inducted, and he read off the list of people, I was really overwhelmed. The members of the ECAC, the members of this year's class, they're giants and leaders of collegiate athletics. And most leaders in the NCAA come through the ECAC. Now, where's Ole's family, Ole Colival? Where are they? Over there. I just want to tell you, when I was a young kid and became the AD of Fordham, we had Division III football. And we decided I had a lot of crazy ideas, but one of the ideas was try to raise it up to 1AA football and join the Patriot League. And I received a lot of resistance and stuff like that. People didn't believe it. Ole was the first guy that believed. And he was the first one, Lafayette was the first one to schedule Fordham. And I'll forever be thankful to your family for what they've done for Fordham. And the last couple of Patriot League championships when we beat Lafayette, I'm always thinking of Ole. right, Eve? Where's Eve Atkinson? Eve, we've had so many good times, yeah. when I was the AD at Fordham in 85, the first thing I did, I brought Julio Diaz with me from Harvard. My wife, Susan, insisted that I bring Julio with me. And the next thing I did was I called Gene Doris, and I asked Gene if he'd come back to his alma mater and help us out. And Gene Doris is really a very, very special person, very committed to the student athlete, has had a tremendous, tremendous career, and is a lifelong friend. So Gene, there's a lot of Fordham people here. I think most of them are here for you. So also, the Fordham people that are here, we're very thankful to Carl Ulrich when he was the AD at Army, and then the executive director at the Patriot League, and Carolyn Femovich. Both of them were kind enough to put up with me, and were very, very supportive. I want to thank the Fordham family. We have a lot of Fordham people here tonight. Especially the coaches, Bridget Baxter, our all-star softball coach. She has a game, she has a big doubleheader tomorrow, but she came up here. So it means an awful lot to Susan and I and the family. I do yoga. Some of the pictures you saw me before yoga, but it's really funny. I did yoga today, and the instructor said to elevate your level. And I started thinking about that. And that's what we all do in college athletics. We want to elevate our level. You want to, as a student or as an athlete, a coach, an administrator, we want to get the most out of ourselves and most out of our student athletes. And that's what everybody here in the ECAC has been so successful at. I thank everyone here for enhancing and enriching my family's life and for putting up with me. I want to introduce my daughter Heather, her husband Chris, and Chris was misguided. He doesn't know about the ECAC as much. He went to Duke as a backup school. When I was younger and I worked at Notre Dame, we were able to recruit some really great athletes, NBA players. And then when I became the AD of Fordham, we were able to really attract great coaches. But the best recruiting job I did was when I recruited a girl from Rockport, Texas. So the love of my life, Susan. So thank you.
Congratulations again, Frank McLaughlin. Actually, I'm lucky enough to, on a weekly basis during the season, I host Ed Cooley's coaches show up at Providence. And one of Ed's assistant coaches is Brian Blaney, a part of the McLaughlin family as well. And coincidentally, Brian actually just texted me yesterday and told me that Frank's yoga website will be coming out and launch in 2 months. So there's a little opportunity for us to plug that. So that's fantastic. Our next inductee is Ellie Lemaire.
Ellie Lemaire has been an early and longtime advocate of Title IX. She joined the staff of Arnold College at the University of Bridgeport in 1964 and coached the only undefeated women's basketball team in that school's history. Away from the sidelines, Lemaire is an accomplished official. She held roles as the basketball chairperson and board chairperson of the Southwest Connecticut Board of Women Officials. In 1976, Lemaire returned to her native Rhode Island to serve as the assistant athletic director for women at the University of Rhode Island. Lemaire has been selected to halls of fame at both the University of Rhode Island and the University of Bridgeport and the Connecticut Women's Basketball Hall of Fame. She has also been the recipient of many other honors and awards, including the Administrator of the Year by the National Association of College Women Athletic Administrators and the ECAC's Catherine Lay Award. The ECAC is proud to welcome Ellie Lemaire to the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Ellie could not be with us tonight. Accepting the award on her behalf is her niece, Rosalind Scheid.
Thank
Thank you. That was John May from the University of Rhode Island, who got up there for the photo op. I worked at the University of Rhode Island for 6 years, and I was lucky enough to meet Ellie. And I will say, she was a pioneer in her day, for those of you that knew her, and an advocate, certainly for women's athletics and athletics across the board. And I will say out loud, I had lunch with Ellie probably about 4 years ago down in Florida, and she's a sweetheart, and please send her all our best. Thank you.
Congratulations again to Ellie LeMaire and family. Our next inductee is Ole Koloval.
Born in Norway, Olaf Koloval immigrated to the United States with his parents and grew up in Brooklyn, New York. He attended Colgate University and was a three-sport athlete in football, hockey, and baseball. After graduating and serving in the U.S. Navy, Koloval began a professional career in baseball and hockey, which was cut short due to an injury in 1948. He was named head coach of hockey and baseball at St. Lawrence in 1950, spent five seasons with the Saints. He would return to Hamilton, New York to coach the Raiders in 1957 and watch the team move up to varsity status and become a founding member of ECAC hockey in 1961. Koloval was named athletic director at Lafayette College in 1965. He is also served as chairman of the NCAA's Eligibility Committee, the Division II Vice President of the NCAA Council, and a past president of the ECAC. Koloval passed away in the fall of 2010 at the age of 87. We are honored to welcome Olaf Koloval to the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Accepting the award on behalf of the family is his granddaughter. Please welcome Jenna Koloval. Congratulations to the Koloval family. Our next inductee is Abby Grossfeld.
Abby Grossfeld's athletic career began as a student athlete at the University of Illinois, where he won four NCAA titles and seven Big Ten championships. He represented the USA internationally from 1952 to 1967 and competed in two Olympic Games in 1956 and 1960. A member of the U.S. Olympic Hall of Fame, Grossfeld served as head coach for the 1984 U.S. Olympic men's gymnastics team that earned eight medals, including the USA's only Olympic team gold medal. During his time with Team USA, Grossfeld was also the head coach at Southern Connecticut State University. He was selected as National Coach of the Year three times and led the men's gymnastics team to three NCAA championships. In 2015, he was the recipient of the Frank Baer Award at the International Gymnastics Hall of Fame. It is with great pleasure that we honor A.B. Grossfeld and welcome him to the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Congratulations, A.B. Grossfeld.
I want it in there, it'd be better. Okay. Thought I'd say a few words. First, thank you very much for this great honor. And I'd like to thank the hundreds of athletes that I coached over 41 years at Southern Connecticut. And if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be here. I thought I'd give you a little background about the ECAC and gymnastics. Originally, and formally, the Eastern College Gymnastics Competition started in 1926 before the ECAC was established. And eventually, that league, which was the Eastern Intercollegiate Gymnastic League, became part of the ECAC. And many, before the NCAA started in gymnastics, which was 1938, athletes from across America came to compete in the EIGL. And that was more or less a national title for them because there wasn't any NCAA then. The ECAC in 87 started their own championship, but it was for individuals, not team. And by 1998, the EIGL and the ECAC joined forces. And as I mentioned, the EIGL, the Eastern Intercollegiate Gymnastic League, was always associated with the ECAC. And my involvement with them has been about 55 years, with 41 years as a coach, not only at Southern Connecticut. Well, 1 year I was at the Coast Guard Academy. And then the other remaining years was as a judge in gymnastics. Southern Connecticut applied for the membership in EIGL, and they were rejected. And the reason probably was because as a Division II school, Southern Connecticut beat Penn State in competition, and they were the NCAA Division I champions. And then a few years later, we did the same thing with Nebraska when they won the NCAA championships. But after a few years, we were accepted, and we got into the EIGL, and I guess their reasons were justified because we won the 10 consecutive EIGL championships in a row. And then both the EIGL and the ECAC merged and became one conference. Now with the Olympics coming up, matter of fact, this weekend are not only the NCAA championships for men and women, Division I, it's also the qualifications, final qualifications for gymnastics in Rio. And the US men and women have already qualified. And many people ask me how we'll fare in the Olympics. Well, our women are undoubtedly the favorites. They're like by far the best right now. And the men will be battling out probably for third because the Japanese and Chinese are just a good step or two ahead of us. But we'll be fighting Russia, and Great Britain's very good. So it'll be between the three of us. So that's where that is. And again, I'm very grateful to be given this honor. And I'd like to congratulate all the other distinguished recipients. Thank you.
Thank you, Coach. And I guess, you know, a year ago, our ECAC EIGL Men's Gymnastics Championships was at West Point. Is Boo Corrigan here? Boo was coming tonight. They did a wonderful job. It was just, it's one of our jewels. And I'm not just saying that because Coach Grossfeld is getting honored tonight, but the ECAC EIGL Men's Gymnastics League and Championship is just wonderful. We actually, Temple, who dropped Men's Gymnastics, still competes. And it was pretty neat. They wear t-shirts that it says cut but not broken. And I give them a lot of credit. Anyway, last year, I went Coach Grossfeld, still he's one of our judges, I went up to say hi to AB. He introduced me to his fellow judge. He said, Kevin's one of my former students. Now, mind you, I wasn't a gymnast, but I'll never forget, as a bright-eyed freshman at Southern Connecticut taking my skills classes, the one rotation was basketball, which I had Don Pirelli, who left Southern Connecticut to go to St. John's and had a wonderful 20-something year career at Northwestern. I had volleyball, which George DeLeon, how about that, Jeff? With volley, all right, who was last year was with the Cleveland Browns, and this year, and now is with Temple. Then I had A.B. Grossfeld for gymnastics. Now, you gymnast people, Peter Corman was in my freshman class, if you remember Peter Corman. Peter Corman was the first United States gymnast in how many years, Coach, to win a medal in the Olympics? 44 years. Now, mind you, Billy Siska, Paul Linehan, if you remember those names, they were looking at Peter cross-eyed during volleyball and basketball. Well, let me tell you something. We got them gymnastics. You know who had the last laugh. God bless him. But anyway, Coach, I'll never forget that. It was wonderful. And we are determined, all right, to help grow the ECAC Men's Gymnastics League. I'll give a plug for alma mater. Right, Coach? We met. We are determined to bring back the men's gymnastics team at Southern Connecticut. We have the women's coach here, Jerry Nelson, the former women's coach, Pat Panicius, over here, and the director of the division emeritus of health, physical education, recreation, and athletics at Southern Connecticut, Carolyn Vanacore. I had to give my alma mater a plug. Thank you.
Our next inductee is Jack Powers.
Jack Powers is a name that's been synonymous with New York City college basketball since the late 1950s. He spent 10 years as the head men's basketball coach at his alma mater, Manhattan College. After his coaching days were over, Powers was named athletics director, a position that he held for 9 years. And during that time, Jasper Athletics experienced tremendous growth in both the men's and women's programs. Powers has been president of many New York City athletic associations and took over as executive director of the NIT in 1988. Recipient of numerous awards, he's been inducted into the Manhattan College Hall of Fame, Catholic High School Athletic Association Hall of Fame, Brooklyn's Old Timer Hall of Fame, and the Mamaroneck High School Hall of Fame. Powers was honored by the ECAC December 2015 with a Lifetime Achievement Award. And on February 26th of this year, Powers was the first Jasper to have his number 34 uniform retired. The ECAC is proud to welcome Jack Powers into the ECAC Hall of Fame, class of 2016.
Congratulations, one and only Jack Powers, ladies and gentlemen.
Cane. The one and only Jack Powers. Wow, that's quite an introduction. Kevin, I'm honored to receive this award from the ECAC and Don Cook for nominating me. I go back a long way with the ECAC. Remember, the ECAC was down in New York City, and it was in the Hotel Roosevelt where they started, and it wasn't much of a place. But they decided with Scotty White, Lord rest his soul, and Bill Flynn, that they were going to close that office down in New York, and they moved up to the Cape. And I think that was a terrific move, a beautiful building up there. But Kevin, I'll have to say this is also a wonderful building, and for the ECAC. But I know, I wish that Scotty and a lot of my friends were here. When you come to an affair like this, you find out who has passed on. And all I can do is say a prayer for them. But again, thank you very, very much, and I appreciate this award. Thank you.
All right, at this time, we will begin dinner. Enjoy. Please enjoy your meal. We'll be back shortly. Okay, I hope we enjoyed dinner. We're going to continue on, but first, Kevin McGinnis.
Thank you, Vin. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you've enjoyed your meal and dessert. Before we continue, the ECAC would like to thank the Matrix Conference and Banquet Center for this evening's excellent service and outstanding meal. Please give them a hand. I thought the meal was great. Thank you. Also, and actually, I wrote this down on a separate piece of paper, and I forgot to say before that the Whitelaw family did tell us there will be a memorial service for Scotty. We will get out a formal announcement so everyone knows, but it will be Sunday, June 5th, 1 p.m. at fittingly at the Hyannisport Golf Club. So we will get something out on that so everyone knows. What I'd like to do is also acknowledge the ECAC staff in attendance this evening, Executive Assistant and Office Manager Megan Crystal, Bushnell Assistant Dylan Clark, David Servidio, Aaron Kolodny, ECAC Columbia University graduate intern Steve Chasey, General Manager of ECAC Sports Properties Devin Berg, Coordinator of Sport Administration for New Media and Digital Communications Ben Horner, Associate Vice Presidents for Championships, Leagues, and Affiliates Lori Mazza, Associate Vice President for Finance and Administration, who you met earlier, John Rollins. And last but not least, the young lady who coordinated this evening's event, Director of Sport Administration for Marketing and Communications, Megan O'Brien. Please give Megan a real nice hand. We're also grateful to have with us tonight ECAC Division I and Hockey Commissioner, Steve Hagwell. Steve, coming off a wonderful Frozen Four run, and I'd also like to acknowledge a good friend and former colleague who was responsible for the voiceovers tonight, and that's Billy Schweitzer, who is the voice of the Quinnipiac Bobcats. Billy did a wonderful job. Bill had a good week covering the Frozen Four and Quinnipiac's run. Also, some people don't know this, we were talking about it earlier, Bill celebrated the Villanova National Championship also. Some of you people may or may not remember, Tim Tolikin and I were just talking about it. Bill Schweitzer was the radio voice of the 1984-85 Villanova team that won that last national championship for Villanova. So we thank Billy. He was going to join us tonight, but unfortunately wasn't feeling well. I'd also like to give certainly an ECAC shout out to our member athletic directors that are present. We have Ryan Bamford from UMass. We have Don DiGiulia from St. Joe's University. Of course, Gene Doris from Fairfield University. Mark Griffin, Rutgers Newark. Jeff Hathaway from Hofstra University. Ed Matakovic from Westchester University. Danny McCabe from Adelphi University. Our newest athletic director, Marianne Riley from Manhattan College. Former ECAC intern, Paul Schlickman from Central Connecticut State University. And Dana Skinner from UMass Lowell. I want to thank you folks for all of your continued support in the ECAC, and it's certainly wonderful to have you with us tonight. Thank you very much. I'd also like to give a ECAC shout out to COSIDA for, again, all their support in this event and the ECAC and our Hall of Fame. And they're represented tonight by COSIDA board member Ira Thor of New Jersey City University. Thank you, Ira. Also want to acknowledge the Ivy Leagues here. Scotty Rogers, where are you? Scotty? Thank you, Scotty. And I certainly would be remiss if I didn't recognize and acknowledge former ECAC intern and former associate commissioner of the ECAC, current senior associate commissioner of the American Athletic Conference, Tom Ojakian. Tom, OJ, thank you very much for coming back. Again, thank you all for your continued support, and let's move on with the program. Thanks, Vinny.
Thank you, Kevin. Okay, it's now time to continue recognizing our inductees for the 2016 Hall of Fame. Our next inductee is Dick Yoder.
Richard Yoder has spent his entire life contributing to the community of Westchester, Pennsylvania. After graduating from Westchester State Teachers College in 1959 with a degree in health, physical education, and recreation, Yoder enlisted in the United States Marine Corps and served in the reserves until 1965. He has served on the Westchester University faculty for 38 years. Yoder was the director of athletics at Westchester from 1979 through 88, and he was instrumental in enticing the NFL's Philadelphia Eagles to bring their preseason training camps to Westchester for 15 years. Yoder has chaired the NCAA Division II Football Committee and the Pennsylvania State Athletic Conference Football Games Committee. In 1997, the ECAC presented him with the James Lina Distinguished Achievement Award. And following his retirement at the collegiate athletics level, Yoder spent two terms as mayor of Westchester, Pennsylvania. At this time, we'd like to welcome the Honorable Richard Yoder to the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Congratulations, Dick Yoder. Congratulations, Dick Yoder. Our next inductees, the 1972 Westchester University Women's Swimming Team.
Yeah. Led by head coach Barb Layton and assistant Sue Parkinson, the Westchester University 1972 women's swimming team ended a four-year run by Arizona State. The Golden Rams narrowly edged the Sun Devils at the Division for Girls and Women's Sports National Championships. Following that championship win, the DGWS dissolved into the Association for Intercollegiate Athletics for Women. Westchester is the only small school institution to claim the Women's Swimming National Championship from 1968 to 1982, when the NCAA split its membership into three separate divisions based on the size of the school. Westchester secured regular season wins over Temple and Penn before claiming its national championship. It is with great pleasure and honor that we welcome the 1972 Westchester University women's swimming team into the ECAC Hall of Fame, class of 2016.
Congratulations, the 1972 Westchester University women's swimming team. Come on up, Dr. Eve Atkinson, Helen Husty, Mary Krawchuk, Julie McMullen, Cecilia McCloskey, Corinne Quinn, Mandy Schneff, and Nina Smith. Congratulations. Congratulations. Ladies and gentlemen, our next inductee is Carl Ulrich.
Carl Ulrich was the first civilian to be named Director of Athletics at the United States Military Academy in 1980. During his 10 years, Ulrich worked diligently to maintain and upgrade the posture of Army's intercollegiate athletic teams. He's credited with the turnaround of the football program under his leadership. Army captured three Commander-in-Chief trophies and three bowl appearances. Ulrich was also the driving force behind the construction of the Hollander Center and the east stands of Mikey Stadium, as well as the creation of the Truxton Lacrosse Center. He served as president of the Metro Atlantic Conference, was on the executive committee of the National Association of College Directors of Athletics, and in 1995 he was presented the ECAC's James Lina Distinguished Achievement Award and was the first administrator elected to the Army Sports Hall of Fame in 2007. We are proud to welcome Carl Ulrich to the ECAC Hall of Fame, class of 2016.
Congratulations, Carl Ulrich.
Guys make me feel very humble, and I appreciate it. There's a couple of groups here I'd just like to say a word about. A group came down from West Point, and I just appreciate so much their making the effort to be here. A wonderful institution, and I enjoyed my 10 years there, at least once we started to win in football. Also got a lot of my family here, and they were the rowdy group over there, and announced my name. Two of our three sons are here. A granddaughter of whom I'm very proud. She was just made a general editor of ESPN, the magazine. She was she was the editor of the Daily Tar Heel when she was at North Carolina. There's also a lady here who about 63 years ago took a chance on a rookie high school math teacher and football and lacrosse coach, and she's still with me 63 years later, and it's the best thing that ever happened to me.
Let's hear it again for Carl Ulrich. Our next inductee is Carolyn Femovich.
A graduate of Valparaiso, Carolyn Shiel Femovich is a pioneer for all-female athletic administrators. In 1999, she was appointed as the executive director of the Patriot League and was one of two women to hold the top post at the NCAA Division I level. Throughout her tenure at the Patriot League, Femovich focused on key areas, including the development of a comprehensive digital network, expansion of the league membership, and improvement of the league's competitiveness. Femovich served in national leadership positions with the NCAA as the chair of the Division I Championships and Competition Cabinet, the NCAA Management Council, the Division I Women's Basketball Committee, and also as president of the Eastern College Athletic Conference, the ECAC. This past fall, she was presented with the ECAC Catherine Lay Award. We are honored to welcome Catherine Shiel Femovich to the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Congratulations, Carolyn Shiel Femovich.
Good evening. So great to be here this evening and see so many, I'm going to say old friends, but colleagues. And, you know, it's just a great association to be here. I've been asked to say a few words on behalf of all the inductees tonight, and, you know, very happy to do that. I certainly want to thank Kevin McGinnis and the staff of the ECAC for all of their good work. Let me try this a little bit differently here. Am I okay? For all of their good work, and certainly Megan O'Brien, you've been just great with staying in touch with all of us and helping us coordinate all the activities, and we thank you very much for that. I think we all feel privileged and blessed to have worked in college athletics. I think the opportunity to, whether it's to serve as a student athlete on one of our campuses, to coach, to be administrators, or even to officiate or do a little bit of all of the above. It is really a blessing and a privilege to be able to work in college athletics. For me personally, it has been both my vocation, but also my avocation. And I'm not sure that many of us get to work in something that we love to do each and every day. But my entire career was spent focusing on student athletes, their experiences, how we could make their experience better, and to understand how that experience really was going to translate into a lifetime of success and achievement for them, because I think we all believe firmly that athletics is part of the educational experience and is something that really advances and furthers our student athletes' lifetime. None of us achieves any kind of recognition because we seek it. I think we all work in college athletics because we really love it and we believe in student athletes. But it is very nice to receive awards and recognition. And so I want to congratulate all of the honorees tonight. But I also want to say thanks to all of our colleagues and friends who are here, the people who have supported us as mentors, as colleagues and friends, because it truly is a team effort, whether you're coaching or administrating or officiating or working from the sidelines. It is a team effort, and we wouldn't be able to do the things we do in leadership roles for intercollegiate athletics without a strong team effort. And I think lastly, we all need to recognize the support of our family, our friends, our colleagues. For me, my spouse and husband of 25 years has been an immeasurable source of strength for me, and he's with me here this evening, Bob Femovich. He has certainly allowed me to do the job and put in the time demands and kind of create the kind of energy that I needed in the job while making sure that everything was going smoothly on the home front. And so none of us does that without a very strong support system at home, and we thank them for that. I think just in closing, want to say thanks again to the selection committee. It is a tremendous honor to be recognized by your peers. And then also congratulations to all the other award winners. We celebrate tonight with you and with your loved ones. So thank you very much.
Congratulations again. Our next inductee is Jack Riley.
Before there was a Herb Brooks and the Miracle on Ice team in 1980, there was Jack Riley and Team USA in 1960 winning an Olympic gold medal. Riley's collegiate career was put on hold during his sophomore season at Dartmouth when he joined the United States Naval Air Corps as a pilot. Riley returned to Hanover in 1946 to captain and coach the team that tied the University of Toronto for the North American title. Riley would join the staff at the United States Military Academy in 1950, and he became the head coach a season later, a position that he held until 1986. He was named the NCAA Coach of the Year twice and guided the Black Knights to 29 winning seasons. Riley is a member of the United States Hockey Hall of Fame, the International Hockey Hall of Fame, and the Army Sports Hall of Fame. Sadly, Coach Riley passed away earlier this winter, but we are honored to induct Jack Riley into the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Congratulations to Jack Riley and his family accepting the award on his behalf. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the head men's ice hockey coach for Army West Point, his son, Brian Riley. Congratulations to the Riley family. Our next inductee is Gene Doris.
Gene Doris has spent over 30 years in college athletics, beginning at Fordham University as an athletic administrator and coach, followed by 5 years at Marist College as director of athletics. In his 22 years at Fairfield University, Doris has been instrumental in revitalizing the athletic facilities on campus and forging a partnership with the Webster Bank Arena in Bridgeport to be the home of the Stags men's basketball team. In 2015, Doris unveiled Conway Field at Rafferty Stadium as the state-of-the-art home for the Fairfield men's and women's lacrosse teams. Lessing Field, home of the Fairfield men's and women's soccer, also saw major developments, including a new Daktronics video board. In 2010, he received the Division I Northeast Athletic Director of the Year Award. Doris served his term as chairman of the ECAC Board of Directors and is still currently active as the past chair. It is with great pleasure that we welcome Gene Doris to the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Congratulations. Please welcome Fairfield University Athletic Director, Gene Doris. Our next inductee is Steve Bamford.
Steve Bamford's career began at the high school level as a teacher and a principal. He transitioned into intercollegiate athletics in 1987 when he was hired to lead his alma mater, Plymouth State, as the director of athletics. He spent 13 years with the Panthers before taking over as commissioner of the Pilgrim League and the Freedom Football League. Bamford has been a chair of the Division III Football Committee and held various positions at the ECAC. In 2000, Bamford was named the assistant commissioner of the league and then held the interim commissioner title for a short time. In 2000, he was named the ECAC's senior associate commissioner. Currently, Bamford is the special assistant to ECAC president and CEO, Dr. Kevin McGinnis. We are honored to welcome Steve Bamford to the ECAC Hall of Fame, Class of 2016.
Congratulations, Steve Bamford.
as King Henry VIII said to each of his wives, I won't keep you long. I want to thank Kevin McGinnis and the ECAC Hall of Fame Committee for selecting me for this great honor. I also want to extend my congratulations to the other inductees who are being honored here this evening. You all have experienced extraordinary careers and have done great things in the world of intercollegiate athletics. And the people you have all touched are better for having known and worked with you. I want to take a moment to introduce my two sons, Todd and Ryan, who have come here tonight to celebrate this honor with their old man. Both Todd and Ryan proudly work at two ECAC member institutions, the University of Hartford and the University of Massachusetts, respectively. My wonderful wife, Donna, who has been by my side on each step of the way through Plymouth State and ECAC, on the ECAC journey, did not make the trip tonight, choosing to stay in Florida tonight with our caring for our two dogs, both but certainly wanted to be remembered to all of the good friends here in the audience this evening. Our daughter Kate and her family are living outside of Seattle and would have been here had they lived closer. Also want to thank all of my colleagues who I've been blessed to have worked with over the past 29 years at Plymouth State and at the ECAC. Great people, outstanding ambassadors for both institutions, and the best employment partners any person could ever have. In all my years of coaching and teaching and administration, both at the high school and collegiate level, including my 13 years at Plymouth State and my 16 years at the ECAC, I honestly can say that I haven't worked a day in my life. I've always enjoyed going to work every day, primarily because of the work environment, the exciting challenges within the job, and the people I have worked with. I will leave you with one final thought that I hope will resonate with all of you. Think of the countless millions of Americans who hate Monday mornings and the thought of going to work. I've always told our children to seek out a career you are passionate about, a job that you love, and a job that challenges your mental, physical, and emotional being. If you are fortunate to have this type of job, you will experience the joy and excitement of going to work every day, especially those Monday mornings. I ask you all to think back tonight on our careers as athletic administrators and how fortunate and blessed we have been in being involved in college athletics. I wouldn't trade my career for anyone else's. Thanks again for the great honor tonight. I am deeply appreciative of being a 2016 inductee into the ECAC Hall of Fame. Thank you.
Congratulations again, Steve. Now to say a few words on the behalf of the ECAC Board of Directors, please welcome back up Gene Doris.
Thanks, thanks, Vinny. It's a great honor to be speaking both for myself as an inductee into the Hall of Fame tonight, and in addition to that, on behalf of the Board of Directors. I can't say enough. I think the evening itself gives you the reason why there needs to be an ECAC. I mean, when you take a look at all of the great honorees in the room this evening, it's testament to what has been the ECAC over the years. I was actually stunned when Don Cook gave me a call a couple of months ago and said, I'm calling to honor you to that you're going to be inducted into the ECAC Hall of Fame. I thought he was kidding first. Because when I look around the room and I was aware of who all the others were that were going in, I certainly am probably the last and the least when it comes down to it in terms of going into the Hall of Fame. But I'm deeply touched by it. I think as I look around the room, I think everything that everybody has said this evening with regard to what it's all about, I think Carolyn, who I've been a colleague with in many, many ways over the years, you know, Steve Bamford, all of the inductees that spoke, I think are testament as to what intercollegiate athletics is all about. It's a special, special place to work. no matter what institution, Division I, Division II, Division III, junior college, you name it. And we're all really blessed to have had the opportunity to do it. And I am grateful to have the opportunity to work for, at Fairfield for 22 years so far with some great people. I would be totally remiss on a personal note not to thank the staff that makes me look good. Zach Dayton, Alan Gibson, Pat Murphy, Allison Sexton. You know, these are the people that that make my life easy when it comes down to it. They've been with me for a considerable amount of time, Zach a little bit less than the rest. But when it comes down to it, these are the people, all of us have staffs like that that really make us look good on a daily basis. And I think we have the only table that has two former athletic directors at Fairfield University. And we have Don Cook, who preceded me into the Hall of Fame last year and was in the inaugural class, an alumnus of Fairfield, has been a great mentor and colleague to me over the years. And George Basaka, great friend also, who basically is the godfather of basketball at Fairfield University and really set the tone. So I again, I'm extremely grateful for all of the help and assistance that I've gotten. So, and Jack Powers, you know, what can anybody say? Great player, great coach, great athletic director, head of the NIT for a long time. So, you know, I could go on and I could go on. They usually give me the invocation, but they're afraid I put people to sleep early. So they gave me the end this time in order to make sure that I didn't go too long. And the guy that gave me my first job in intercollegiate athletics actually twice. Frank McLaughlin, who got me my first gig working with Digger Phelps and him on the basketball staff at Fordham University. Crazy situation. I'm standing there during senior week, during graduation week, and here comes Frank on campus, and I'm saying, what the heck are you doing here? You graduated last year. And he said, you know, I'm going to be starting with Digger, new guy. Why don't you come over and meet him and whatever? And the rest was history. And, you know, we had a terrific year, and I can't thank him enough. And he was thoughtful enough when he became the athletic director at Fairfield University, at Fordham University, to say, come on back and work for your alma mater again. And that's really what launched my career. And so for that, I'm eternally grateful for Frank and all that he's done. And being the Fordham is my alma mater, the work that he continues to do at Fordham University for all the athletes and all the alums. So on behalf of the board, I can't tell you the hours that the board members put in as volunteers. I don't think a lot of people realize how much goes into the work that goes on. But like the Hall of Fame tonight, the Hall of Fame committee, and the time and the effort that they have to put in to screen people, all of that, and all the other committees that the ECAC has to work very hard on behalf of all the member institutions and the student athletes. I think they deserve a lot. This is a night for them as well in terms of a celebration. And so for all of you, congratulations. Thank you all for being here on behalf of the board. And keep the faith with the ECAC. We're moving into a new era. And you know, as you heard earlier, there was the era in New York, there was the era moving up to the Cape, and now there's a new era in Connecticut. And the ECAC will continue to move forward and flourish, thanks to the staff and all of the good people that work with it. Thanks so much.
Thanks so much, Gene. Before Kevin comes back up to wrap it up, real quick, John Rollins would like to say a few words.
First, I just again want to thank everybody for coming tonight, and congratulations to all the inductees. But I also want to thank our staff. Our staff has put in a lot of time over the past 9 months since we've all started here. And one particular person I really want to thank tonight is Megan O'Brien. And I'd like you guys to give her a round of applause. She did a great job of putting this together. And she has been the rock that has gotten this event going. So thank you guys all, and thank you again, and good night.
Kevin McGinnis to wrap it.
Thank you, John. And again, yes, Megan and the staff, certainly without you, we wouldn't have this. You do a wonderful job. I just like at this point to please give our Master of Ceremonies a round of applause. Parisi, he did a wonderful job. Thank you. And one more great round of applause for the ECAC Hall of Fame Class of 2016. I endorse that. Thank you. And again, on behalf of the ECAC Board of Directors, our staff, our membership, everybody here, thank you for everything. Have a wonderful night. Thanks.